Good morning, everybody. My name's Clara Hemphill. I'm the interim director of the Center for New York City Affairs, which is at the Milano School for International Affairs, Management, and Urban Policy. At our school, we train future people to work in nonprofit organizations and in government, city government. And if any of you want to be students at our school, we have admission materials at the back. At the Center for New York City Affairs, we identify fixable problems in city government and then work with government officials to fix them. Today, we're looking at a new report, A Better Picture of Poverty, where we discovered that there are 87,000 children in grades K to 5 who miss more than a month of school each year. And we also identified 130 schools where more than a third of the children miss more than a month of school. Chronic absenteeism is important because it affects everybody in the school. It doesn't just affect the students who are missing school, but it also affects the students who are showing up regularly. If you can imagine as a teacher what it's like to teach a different group of kids every day as kids come and go, you can imagine how difficult it is. What we're going to do today is we're going to have keynote address by Deputy Mayor Richard Buery. And then Kim Naur, the lead writer and editor for the report, will present highlights. And then we'll have a panel discussion. At the end, we'll have question and answer. And I think each of you have an index card where you can write your questions, and we'll have people collect them for that. So what we're going to talk about now is what's the best way to help struggling schools, and what's the best way to deal with the effects of deep poverty, which are reflected in very high rates of chronic absenteeism. Deputy Mayor Buery.
Good morning.
All right, so I like just had my first half cup of coffee, so I'm barely awake. But how are you all doing? I will try to revive myself for you. First of all, I want to thank Clara Hemphill. You know, I recently moved back to New York after living in the suburbs for about 7 or 8 years, and have two young sons who I had to find schools for. And so I've been living with Clara Hemphill during that search to find great schools for my kids. So it's great to share a stage with her. I also want to thank Kim Naur for inviting me here today and for all the really great work that you and the center have done to support New York City. I think of all the great things that the Center for New York City Affairs has given New York, probably one of the best is Andrew White, who after spending many years here at the center is now a colleague of mine in city government at the Administration for Children's Services. I just saw Andrew. Where is he? Yeah. Andrew, you stand up and take a round of applause. So look, definitely the new school's loss is absolutely New York City government's gain. So really glad to have you now as a colleague. And like I said before, I really want to thank and congratulate the center for all of its important work, particularly its work on this detailed and rigorous study and to the obstacles that thousands of New York City children are facing. The report documents in a very, very real way a troubling fact of life for everyone in New York City, that all schools are not created equal. And you know, for generations, we've had two school systems in the city. You know, we split our school system into the good schools and the bad schools, and everybody always knows what the good schools are, and they know where they are, and they know what they are, and everybody's already known what the bad schools are, and where they are and what they are. And anybody in New York sort of probably can tell a story about when they started to realize the difference between these two school systems. You know, for me, it was very clearly when I started high school. I grew up in East New York, Brooklyn, which is a community, District 19, School District 19 on the border of Queens, predominantly black and Latino community where a majority of children are born into poverty. but was very lucky that I got into Stuyvesant High School. And it was my first time going to school with students who weren't black or brown, or who weren't from neighborhoods like Brownsville or Bed-Stuy or Bushwick. I mean, the old Bushwick, not the new Bushwick. The old Bushwick. And it was really a shocking experience for me. And I had gone to good schools before then. It's not like I had gone to terrible schools. I had gone to Catholic school until the third grade, and then for middle school, I went to IS 383 in Bushwick, which is an exam school that mostly serves, again, black and Latino kids from central Brooklyn. But, you know, going to Stuyvesant, you really was like going to an entirely different school system. And this was even before we had a fancy building. This was a crappy building near here on 15th Street. But I'll tell you, you know, every day taking that train from Pennsylvania Avenue in East New York to Union Square, you really see the difference of the way life is lived for kids in neighborhoods like East New York and neighborhoods in other parts of the city. In one system, there were very low expectations for children. Even everything from the air quality was bad, the role models were bad, the quality of instruction was bad, the opportunities were bad. But then you had this whole other city where children were not only expected to succeed, but they had the resources to do so, where everyone was going to college. And it was almost impossible to fall through the cracks. Now, I had six kids from my homeroom go to Harvard my senior year. And I don't think there were six kids in all of East New York who went to Harvard my senior year. You know, the tragedy, of course, is that the children that I grew up with in East New York, as we all know, just as smart as all the other kids. They dream just as big. They love just as much. Go to any pre-kindergarten classroom in New York City and you say, what do you want to be when you grow up? You know, the hands will raise. They all want to be firemen. They all want to be doctors and lawyers and astronauts. They want to be teachers. They want to be the president. Nobody raises their hand and says they want to be a high school dropout. Nobody raises their hand and says they want to go to jail. The children who I grew up with in East New York had nothing but promise. They just had the misfortune of growing up in a low-income neighborhood. And by extension, that means that they had the misfortune of being required to go to low-performing schools and under-resourced schools in their community. You know, the center of the disparity between children in different parts of New York City has been and continues to be our school system. You know, we've written off those bad schools, but when we do that, we also simultaneously write off the students who are attending them. The mayor put it earlier this week, we decided some of them had the right to dream great dreams, and others would have the bright hopes of youth extinguished at an early age. You know, in doing that, we also are writing off the principals and the teachers and the guidance counselors, who in all these schools, who care about these kids and love these kids, in my experience, every one of whom entered the profession wanting to make a difference. It doesn't mean that they all had the skills to do it, but they all came in wanting to do it. But too often we don't empower them, we don't give them the tools to be successful, and then we rail at them when they're not successful. The truth is that no neighborhood or school has ever had a monopoly on brains or talent, and no child should have to shrink their dreams to fit the size of the neighborhood they happen to be born into. What we know is that we cannot afford to wait any longer to change this reality for our kids. Now is the time to lay a foundation for a school system that works for all of our children, all of our families. And I'm proud to say that I think we're starting to lay that foundation. Just earlier this week, Mayor de Blasio announced an historic effort to support 94 struggling schools in New York City. We identified those schools not only on the basis of 1 year of test scores, but by looking at a combination of historical performance and current indicators of school quality, indicators that we believe and we understand to be correlated with schools that have the potential to succeed. These are the schools that we have identified as those most in need of help, and they very much suffer for the reasons that are outlined in the report, A Better Picture of Poverty. And so we're beginning with those schools. It's not a surprise that for the most part, these schools tend to be in low-income neighborhoods. They often serve a disproportionate number of children in foster care or in temporary housing. They often exist in communities with high crime rates and less access to health care. We call these schools renewal schools because we were committed to renewing them through added resources and through accountability. As a centerpiece of this work, we're going to make each one of these renewal schools a community school. Community schools embody the value that we believe should drive public education and make a real difference in student achievement. Community schools make sure parents know that they have a stake in the school their children attend. You know, getting parents involved in school is not just a nice idea. It's not just a bonus. It is critical for an effective school. When parents believe in a school and feel that they are invested in their children, when they feel they're invested in their school, their children undoubtedly benefit. We're acting quickly to create and sustain and strengthen the parent-teacher associations and school leadership teams in all of these schools. These community schools will also provide extended learning time. Each renewal school will have an extended school day, an extra hour of academic instruction. Now, the mayor joked that he wasn't sure how good the kids would feel about that. But we're confident that extra hour of instruction will make a real difference in their learning. In addition to that hour, renewal schools will have after-school and summer programs, which can give students additional opportunities for academic enrichment, for sports, for music, for recreation. And it's hard to overstate how important the opportunity for extended learning time is. We all know about the summer learning gap, the steps back that young people who don't have the opportunity to engage in productive activities during the summer experience that make it so much harder for teachers when they come back to school in the fall. By offering extended summer learning time to kids, we hope to help bridge that summer learning gap. But after school programs as well, for so many kids, the key to coming to school, to wanting to come to school, is to find that spark, that thing that gives them joy. And oftentimes, an after school program can be the thing that gives it to them. Especially for the kid who's not used to succeeding well in English class or math class. It might be the chess program or the dance class or the sports team that give the child the confidence, the connection to school, that get them to come to school regularly every day. Community schools will work to leverage the resources of their community to connect families to the resources they need to be successful. Principals and teachers in community schools will get extra support in the form of coaching and professional development, but they'll also be held strictly accountable for results. And we will do whatever it takes, everything up to and including reorganizing schools, to make sure that children don't suffer. Our community schools will also develop the capacity to determine the needs of children and families in the community and develop strategies to serve those needs. Whether it's the child who needs eyeglasses so they can help see the board, or the parent who needs ESL classes so they can help their child with their homework, or the child who needs counseling because they are dealing with stress and trauma that no child should ever have to deal with, or the child who is missing school regularly because of health reasons, or because of unstable housing, or because they got to stay home to help watch their kids, to watch their younger siblings. Or the kid who goes to school hungry every night, or doesn't have clean clothes to wear to school. Whatever the challenge, a community school understands that it's the job of the school to meet the needs of each and every child in their school, so that children can come to school ready to get about the business of learning, and teachers can get about the business of teaching. Before I joined the administration, I spent 5 years, I had the real honor to lead the Children's Aid Society, which is an organization which has done a lot to develop the community school model in New York. When I was at Children's Aid Society, I got to know an extraordinary family whose lives were changed for the better when they entered PS5, a community school we operate in Washington Heights. The mother was a recent immigrant from the Dominican Republic who barely spoke English. Her husband struggled to find a job while they were raising a little boy and another child on the way. Not surprisingly, she became overwhelmed with the stress of her life in New York. She became depressed. But thankfully, she looked for support and she found it at PS5. The PS5 is an early Head Start program for pregnant moms, which offers prenatal supports and early childhood education. So working with parents to get them ready to be good teachers, the first and best teachers for their children. Over time, her and her family became more involved in PS5. Both their kids participated in the Head Start program there. They went up in school, they participated in the after school and summer program there. They got their health care from the school-based health clinic. The mom became a real leader in the school. She got a job there as the parent coordinator, and her husband joined the custodial staff. Both of her children are now enrolled in college, and they credit the PS5 community school with transforming their lives. These are the kinds of stories that make us believe in the power of community schools. These stories inspire us to build a system that gives all families a chance to turn their lives around. We've begun to make real progress in transforming our schools. We've already invested $52 million in attendance improvement and dropout prevention funds to develop 45 community schools, working closely with Sheena Wright and her colleague at the United Way to launch this effort at schools around New York City. This is separate from the mayor's announcement this week to invest $150 million to launch the renewal schools, including the community schools programs at 94 schools here in New York City. So in conclusion, we know that the task ahead of us is a difficult one. We are not naive enough to think that there is a single silver bullet that will solve all of our system's challenges. We know that every community is different. We know that every school is different. And every struggling school will have a unique path to success. But we also know there are some things that all of our schools have in common. They all have children who are able to learn. They all have parents who love their children. They all have educators who want to teach. And they all have communities that want to help. What we need to do is to add a fifth element to this equation. We need to add a city that is truly committed to success for everyone. So on behalf of Mayor de Blasio and Chancellor Farinia and the entire administration, I want to make this promise. We refuse to give up on any child. We will do everything we can to get them to school every day, to develop their love of learning, and to support their individual needs by strengthening their communities and their schools. We will not stop until we have the school system our city deserves and that our city demands. Our children's future depends on it, and so we will insist on giving them every chance to succeed. I want to thank you all for your partnership and your support, and I look forward to working with you on this important work as we move forward. Thank you.
Good morning, everyone. Thanks for coming out on this rainy day. For those of you who braved the east side of the city, I apologize for the Eventbrite mistake. But these things happen, and it gave you a little extra exercise this morning. So it's all good. It's nice to see this room, so many familiar faces. My name is Kim Naur. I'm the Education Research Director here at the Center for New York City Affairs at the New School. And this is my report. It's 4 years in the making. And before I start my presentation on the report, which will give you some of the highlights, and obviously I encourage you to dig deep and read the actual stories in the report, which are very colorful and bring to life the schools that Deputy Mayor Buery is talking about. I want to thank my co-authors on the report, most especially Nicole Mader and Tom Jacobs, who are both here today. Nicole especially is responsible for all the graphics that you see in those reports, and I make an argument here today that I think that the graphics could be transformative in the school system just simply because they make hard information easier to understand, and that's really important for principals who are so busy. Here's your NPR moment, your PBS moment, but this research would not have been possible without the generous support from the Robert Sterling Clark Foundation, who started funding this had faith in this project 4 years ago, the Cyrus Fund, Susan Halperin, our greatest supporter, the Donors Education Collaborative, and some last-minute money from the United Way of New York City. So thank you all. So I want to, let's see if this works. I think all of you are familiar in this room with this face. This is Dasani. And she was the main character in the New York Times article about a year and a half ago about a homeless family who lived in Fort Greene. In that series, what struck me, we vividly saw, how she related to everybody in her life, but the one institution, if you remember that six-part series or whatever it is, the one institution besides her family that mattered to her, that was important to her, given all the many social service organizations in her life, was her school. And that's like something that's really important to remember, is that the schools are a place where children like Dasani can find sanctuary. Our question as a group and as a city is how do we do a better job of helping schools be there for the large number of children that we have like her? 20,000 homeless children in this city, and many others who are dealing with various aspects of that hard aspects of poverty. There's obviously many important facets to this question, and as Deputy Mayor Buery's hinted at a little bit, there's no doubt that developing school leaders and those caring, talented teachers is probably job one in any school. We don't take issue with that. That's critically important. There's also important ideas about school culture, everyone working together to help the children learn. And just now we're developing new science on how to be more effective instructors, right? But all good, crucial work. But in our efforts to improve schools, I feel like we've forgotten one important question. Are the kids actually coming regularly? And if they aren't, maybe that's something we should pay attention to. Importantly, I'm not talking about filling out bubble sheets or doing robocalls or all this administrative work that many principals just associate attendance with. Instead, in this report, I argue it is one of the, if not the best measures of school poverty we have. And if we can measure school poverty, maybe we can do a better job of helping to deal with it. In our time here today, I will lay out possibilities associated with this very important school metric, and then our panel will talk about what we can do in school and as a city to help children who tend to miss the most school, which is our lowest income kids, the Dasanis in our school. Walk you through some of the aspects of this report, and obviously you can follow along in your book if you wish. So the first thing to see is that we have that by absenteeism is very closely linked with test scores and with academic achievement. So you see here, this is the crowd I'll be talking about today. These are schools which have high levels of chronic absenteeism year after year after year after year. These schools have persistently high levels of chronic absenteeism. And what does that mean? A student is chronically absent if they've missed more than one in every 10 days of school. We know in our report that older students miss the most school. These are your high schoolers who cut out or have reasons that they can't be in school. But this report focuses on elementary school children, where we have a real opportunity to intervene early and hopefully avoid problems down the road. Some 87,000 children, grades K through 5, were chronically absent in 2012-13. That is more than many cities in America. 87,000 children. That number has been improving thanks to the very, very good work of the DOE over the last few years, but it's still a very large number and one we need to pay attention to. Let me see, how do I do backspace here? So here's a map, and we had this in our original report that I published, an original report on chronic absenteeism back in 2008. Something similar, although the colors have improved a little bit, but you can see Not surprising to folks in this room that the highest numbers are closely tied to neighborhoods. On this map, we see the highest rates in Harlem, the South Bronx, Central Brooklyn. And in these areas, on average, 25 to 30% of the children or more, there's plenty of schools where 40% of the children are chronically absent year after year, 40%. And they're in these neighborhoods, and those children are missing 10% of their school year, which is an enormous amount of time, especially when we think about how short our school year actually is in some ways. What does this actually look like? Okay. Sorry. Oop. Okay. So here's another report, another graphic in the book. This was... a tool that my team used. We had our, just a little bit of a backstory on our research. We had 13 schools that volunteered to work with us, and we spent intensive time in those schools in 2011-12. And one thing that we did as a service for the schools that wanted us to do it was create what we call an attendance diagnostic for them. And this is a nice tool that some of you guys might want to think about in your own work. We saw, what we would do is we create this chart for them, and this is a way of sort of seeing attendance patterns in the school. So take a look at this chart. This is a chart showing the missed days. It's really just one month in that school year, and a month that matters, January. It doesn't have any vacations. It's back to school. Everybody should be excited. So this is January 2012. These are 45 students, which is the equivalent of, like three classrooms in this school, Granville T. Woods, which, by the way, we felt like was a really good school with really caring staff and that who really keyed into the what their student needs were, right? Something graphically like this gives you a sense of how this looks. Look at student number one here. He only went to school 3 days that month, right? We should be concerned about that. And then we have another student here, student number eight. He or she, I don't know, has this sort of sporadic attendance, but it's still, more school was missed. The red squares represent days lost than he or she was there. And then graphs like this can also give principals clues about oddball things, oddball patterns in their school. So look at this one. This was a Wednesday, a middle of the week, and a very large number of children were missing in this little group that we're talking about. And these patterns are all the way down the database. So then you have to sort of say, what's going on? How do I see this? And when we presented this data diagnostic to the folks at Granville T. Woods, they were amazed. First of all, they had no idea that their chronic absenteeism rate was 42%. 42% of their kids were missing more than 10% of their school year. They were not aware of it emotionally. They did not get it emotionally, even though they knew they were making a lot of calls in the morning, right? So I just say that one thing that we have to think about is that this problem really does exist, and you can see it graphically that kids are missing a lot of school right there at peak learning time. Okay. Now, so this is another cool chart in your book. It's called, it's what I call the heartbeat of New York City. And you sort of have to look at it in the book yourself. This is a little fuzzy up there, but it's pretty fuzzy. But so here is the first half of the year. I'm going to break this up a little bit for you. And you can see, first, why presenting the data like this is so important. So just to show you what you're looking at, there's three lines here. The bottom line is another one of my case study schools, PS 140, a school I also like a lot, and it's in Morrisania, in one of the poorest neighborhoods in the Bronx. The top school is PS 321, a school that we all know well from this very famous school in Park Slope, and it sort of represents the ultimate middle class school. So it's like sort of a top and a bottom. And then in the middle is sort of the citywide average, once again, elementary schools. And so one thing that you can see just taking a look at this is that there really is a heartbeat of attendance for the whole city. Like, so when principals say they don't have complete control over attendance, they're right. Things happen, right? However, there's also some really revealing things. So One thing to note is that we lose a lot of kids to holidays. In this case, what you're looking at there is Halloween, where a lot of parents choose not to send their kids to school because they're afraid to, right? Okay, that's an important thing to understand. Another thing that we send ourselves, another thing is weather, okay? So the two spikes down you see are our weather-related events in those blue lines, but you'll see that PS321 didn't lose any kids to weather, right? So weather affects low-income kids much more than it affects high-income kids. And so that's, once again, something we have to think about as a strategy, both school-wide and city-wide, is there something we can do about the weather? You know, but really, with families. And then here's one of my personal favorites, half days. Okay, so we lose so many children to half days, and you're going to see it even more in the next slide. And so we have to ask ourselves, even though we've just added more half days, I think, with the parent stuff, is that a productive way to do it, or should we maybe reduce that somehow? So here's the second half of the chart. And kids do go to school on certain days, testing days. So you see these giant sort of spikes up. These are the ELA tests. Over here with the line, you can see the spike up, and that's the math test. But then what I think is kind of interesting, and I definitely see this myself in my own life, and I've seen it in schools, as soon as those math tests are over, school ends. I mean, like, and so you see that almost immediately, like, that the entire city takes a breather. And they all stay out of school for a while, or a significant number. Absenteeism really sort of increases after that sort of moment of the test, right? And then here's another place where everybody takes a breather, the entire month of June. And so we're ending the school year on the 28th of June, and you have a lot of children who are just choosing to opt out of that month of June. And that's something need to build strategies around that. And the final thing, these are the clerical half days. Clerical half days. What are we doing with those half days, and is there a reason for them? Because you see how much that kids are missing on those days. So this is sort of the piece de resistance of our book, and it's the one that really keys in most about what we're going to be discussing on the panel, which is this idea of risk load. And so I did a lot of work on the absenteeism, but I was trying to figure out, you know, what does it reflect in a way that's useful for policymakers, okay? And so first, you know, why does this matter? At the school level, you have to understand, you have to be aware of what's going on in terms of risk load and absenteeism, right? An important conclusion of this report is that absenteeism is closely related to community and school risks. We tested that statistically in a lot of different ways, you'll see in the book, and ranging from, you know, poverty and homelessness on one side to unsafe schools and teacher turnover on the other side. So there's both outside and inside, and then you see absenteeism and school level risks capture that so that you can start to figure out, well, what's going on in an individual school? That's the key. The nature of this academic risk and this poverty risk in a school, another thing to understand, and you can see it in the chart, and we have all the schools on our website, so you can see every elementary school there yourself, is that this changes from school to school in very important and significant ways, right? It's not that every school with super high chronic absenteeism, which is how this is sorted, like, so the school on the very top, Charles Houston, it has the highest chronic absenteeism level in the city, and you can see lots of risks there, almost no green, right? And so, and these are all of your high chronic absenteeism schools, and they all mostly risk, right? And so, but let me break this out a little bit. So this is one of Mayor de Blasio's renewal schools, right? A school the reason that they get put on the list was because they have very, very low test scores, and they've not made any significant progress over the past umpteen years. And so that's obviously concerning and something that we all, that's the object of the game is. So this is, the thing about this particular school, you see, is they have just a sea of red there, right? And so PS150 has a lot of risks to be concerned about. And interestingly, a lot of these risks are school-driven risks. Principal turnover, student turnover, safety, engagement, or teacher turnover, safety and engagement. But there's also student mobility on the outside, you know, a lot of kids coming and going, and also ACS, big factor in that school, right? Yet, here's my school, PS140, which has a very high level of chronic absenteeism as well, above 40%, which has been a bit of a mystery to us because they don't really have the school level risks at all. It's a very, very sweet place. And so they have a lot of protective factors in their school, principal stability, low teacher turnover, solid school climate, just a lot of poverty issues on either side in the neighborhoods. And guess what? PS140 is not on Mayor de Blasio's list. So once again, if you have the school-related risk factors with the outside risk factors, you're in trouble academically perhaps, but if you can work on it as a principal in your school building, then you really can protect your students and make some progress. Just to give you a sense of Mayor de Blasio's renewal schools, many of them, obviously he has lots of them, most are middle and high schools, but amongst the elementary schools on his list, here's a bunch of them. And they're in your book, PS92. You know, so you see how many of those renewal schools are on this super heavy, super high risks. I don't think there's, all of them have like 16 and above risks in their schools. So that's just a little snapshot of what the risk tool is. And just to give you a sense of schools with low chronic absenteeism, which is also on the opposite page, and then you see that they, this school down here, PS130, has the lowest rate of chronic absenteeism or the highest attendance, overall attendance in the entire city. And it's not only a sea of green, but a sea of dark green. So they're doing very well on all indicators, both externally and internally. So that's the sort of the highlights of the report. But really the discussion as a city and as a group with you guys, in our bid to make schools more effective and to make them more responsive places to students and to set them up as meaningful anti-poverty efforts in school, like community schools have the potential to be, it is critical that we make factors like risk load and absenteeism visible and easy for educators and folks in the nonprofit sector to think about. I argue that this detective work, really knowing what's happening with the students who aren't coming to school, figuring it out, is the key to understanding what schools could be doing better, potentially to assist their students, at least with the issues that hold them back from the outside. And then obviously it's up to the schools to get the best possible teachers and those kinds of things going. As many of you know, small high schools and transfer schools were important for making kids feel known in their school and helping keep teenagers in school. When otherwise they might have dropped out. It was a big, big shift under Bloomberg to go from these giant schools to small schools. And here in New York City, I think there's general agreement that worked well. It was a really great school reform effort. Finding ways to work one-on-one with younger students and their families on absenteeism and issues associated with poverty risks could potentially have the same effect. Making schools a more of a sanctuary for kids and potentially improving academic outcomes in the process. So what's actually involved in this quest? Is this something that's relatively easy to do once either the principal or the city makes it a priority? Or is it something that's ridiculously hard to do given everything that's on the principal's plate? I mean, that's something we all have to just really come to understand. And so for those questions, we have our panel to answer those kinds of questions. And I would like to invite them up. Okay. While the panel's coming up, just a quick couple pieces of housekeeping. The staff gave you all index cards. We'll have about 30 minutes. Let's see how we're doing on time, if 30 minutes is a true promise. We'll have about 30 minutes beginning around 10 o'clock. It was 10:05 or so. So please start writing down your questions and get them into the hands of the staff walking around. If you can, include your name and your organization, and I'll have the index cards, and I'm going to try to get to as many of those questions as I possibly can in our Q&A period. And then also, we have staff monitoring Twitter, so if you want to use Twitter to send the center a question, folks in the studio audience, we're live casting right now, they might want to take that option. So on to our esteemed guests here. We'll sort of go left, I guess, where everybody is. Okay. I'll go from your left to right here. Closest to me is Deputy Mayor Richard Buery, and we all know him as the Deputy Mayor in charge of strategic initiatives for Bill de Blasio, but he also worked for years and years, as he mentioned, in the social work field, most notably at Groundwork in East New York, which he founded, and Children's Aid Society. And then next to him is Sheena Wright. She is president and CEO of United Way of New York City with tremendous experience and attendance. And they will be running the city's first wave community schools, but also as relevant, if not more relevant for this discussion, Sheena ran Abyssinian Development Corporation, which is a top-notch CBO in Harlem. And they're featured in the homeless article that we wrote there. Dr. Rudy Crew, rumor has it that you know a thing or two about struggling schools. So he's most well known for serving as chancellor under Rudy Giuliani and surviving it better as well as anybody. And coming up with the idea of the chancellor's district for the city's worst academic performers. He is now the president of Medgar Evers College in Brooklyn, which actually is home to college kids coming out of these communities struggling with a lot of issues we'll talk about today. And then we have Patricia Mitchell, Pat Mitchell. She's principal of PS 48 in Jamaica, Queens, and she's one of 77 schools that have the highest poverty rate. Their students have the highest poverty rate in New York City. And her attendance work and her very, very successful attendance work is featured in this report. And then finally, we have Kevin Dayhill Fuchel, who leads up counseling in schools. He works in 65 partner schools citywide with very high needs kids, and he spent his whole life working with kids in who are homeless. So he really understands that group of children. So I have an opening question to get everybody on the panel sort of warmed up, and everybody. So I didn't talk about this at all in the opener, but the genesis of this report was a kind of footnote in a very important book called Lessons from Chicago, which was published by the Chicago Consortium, and it's all about how the best possible way to run schools. Definitely you should all go out, buy a copy if you can. This book, just so you know, is Chancellor Farinha's Bible right now, and so it's important to understand who she's reading. But anyways, they had identified a class of schools that they called the truly disadvantaged. These are, at the time, there was 46 schools in Chicago that were quite different from the rest of the system. The schools confronted an extraordinary concentration of student needs, homeless, kids in foster care, kids living with neglect, abuse, violence. And they said, what is it in these school communities, they asked, that make them these schools so especially hard to improve? Right. Well, I don't know. Let's dig into that. My question to each of you is, this is so that we can give the audience a sense of what our most high-need schools actually look like, particularly elementary schools, but if there's other schools, other levels too, look like. Do you think that these truly disadvantaged schools exist in New York City, and have you been in one? If so, how would you characterize it? What sticks in your head? And I'm also willing to take the if you don't think that this idea is actually a valid one, let me know that as well. You each have 45 seconds. Okay. No, just look at 45 seconds or 60 seconds if you're particularly eloquent. And I'm going to go backwards alphabet here. So Sheen, I'm going to start with you. From your experience maybe running Abyssinian Development Corporation in Harlem, is there a school that pops into your head, and what was it like?
Thank you so much, Kim. Unfortunately, there are too many schools that pop into my head, but I'll pick one as an example. As part of a Promise Neighborhoods initiative that Abyssinian Development Corporation was involved in, we were working with several schools in Harlem. And what we appreciated is that, you know, they all basically had the same numbers of free and reduced lunch, but there were some that had some other particular challenges that I think are highlighted in this report. This one school was co-located with another school in the building, and this school sat dead in the middle of five homeless shelters. Three of them were domestic violence shelters. This school is mentioned in this report as well, and almost 40% of the kids at that school came from those shelters. So when we came in, you know, saying, you know, we want to help and let's talk about, you know, academic rigor and all these other things, the principal was very frank and looked at us and said, half of my kids, at least I know, have not eaten since lunch the day before. God. They come in late for a variety of reasons, and so they haven't had breakfast. They have on the same clothes every day for a week or two at a time. What I need you to do first is help me feed these kids and make sure that they have clean clothes so that they feel secure and safe. And let's get that done first. And, you know, in that same building, the other school that was located in that building had, you know, none of the kids from the homeless shelters were in that school. They had dramatically different academic outcomes and certainly similarly dramatically different challenges.
And that's just definitely, I'm going to cut you, just to keep things moving, but that's an important point we see in the school system is that, and we're not, I mean, you don't even have to talk about the charter schools. Schools in the same building often have very different kids for A, B, or C reasons. Pat Mitchell, you run a school in Jamaica, Queens. Are there any schools in Queens? Do they have poverty in Queens? Or elsewhere, like anything that you know, and once again, 45 seconds, just to warm everybody up.
Okay, so absolutely, in South Jamaica, Queens, we deal with poverty at a very high level and have to find ways to combat it. I will say that the look of poverty has changed. You may have scholars who come into your building who are suffering, but you don't know it because of the J's they have on, the Jordans, what they come to school with, and what their parents are not willing to tell you. But we know that poverty is not just about demographics for us. Poverty is about a culture. So a lot of our parents have this impoverished culture. They don't understand why it's important to be in school. And so that's what we deal with in Queens,
okay,
in addition to your traditional sense of what poverty looks like.
So that's great. Kevin, Dale, Fischel, your organization, Counseling Schools, works with a lot of homeless children. Tell me what you see, 45 seconds or less.
Well, I would say all of Counseling and Schools, partner schools, struggle to some extent, greater or lesser, with poverty. And certainly a school comes to mind recently that we were actually going to run an after-school program in the local community shelter to support that school. And speaking to the principal nearby, when she reported that due to the closure actually of the shelter that Dasani was in, this school now had, a school of 450, now had 150 of its students that were in the homeless shelter, and could we run the after-school program directly in her school as opposed to locating it in the shelter.
So the school became a shelter.
The school had needs that they were seeing that they weren't quite sure how they were going to support or address, and they were looking for the additional support.
Okay. Dr. Rudy Crew, you've been to hundreds of schools, I would imagine, both here in New York City and in other places that you've worked, but is there one that sticks in your mind from the old days, maybe? And how many times has that school been opened or closed since then?
You know, I have a job that I'm going to try to keep.
No, it's okay. It's okay. We're all friends. There's nobody listening on the internet.
Yeah, right.
No one.
That's a what they said as I got on the plane the last time. So I think that my response in 45 seconds would be that the schools that I observe as being the most complex in this area are schools that are characterized by huge variability in everything that they do, whether it's teaching or assessment or the community itself, the entire aspect of schooling life and living life is marked by enormous variability.
What do you mean by variability?
The idea that there's huge volatility in employment rates. There's huge volatility in housing. There's huge volatility in eating, in the availability and access to food. There's huge volatility in what is taught, how it is taught, when it is taught, and the use of technology in teaching it. There's almost no aspect of a child's life that is consistent month to month, day to day, week to week.
Wow. Okay. That's very helpful. And then finale, Deputy Mayor Buery, not putting you on the spot here as a city leader, but because I'm sure all the schools are great now that you've taken over. No, but in your old days, in groundwork, maybe, or growing up, or working with Children's Aid. Take your pick.
Well, look, there's very little I can add to what we just heard. I mean, the answer is that, of course, these schools exist. And the only maybe thing I would say, the insight that I've come to appreciate over the years is that for children in poverty, it is really the complexity of factors that all build on each other is what makes it so difficult for children, makes it so difficult for schools. It is not just that kids are hungry. If that were only the issue, then you could address that issue. It's not just the hunger. It's not just the homelessness. It's not just the trauma. It's all these factors that intersect in a way that hold our children back and create such a devilish challenge for principals who are not trained to address any of these factors and do not have schools that have the built-in resources to address any of these challenges, but that nonetheless have to live with these challenges, because the kids who come into your building at 8:30 is the same kid they were at 8:29. And the same kid they're going to be at 301. And so, you know, when folks often, I mean, part of this debate, we get tied up in debates about what's the role of poverty in education. Is poverty an excuse for teachers not teaching? And I just think it's an unfortunate confusion of the fact, because no one would say that poverty is an excuse for any educator not doing their work. It does not mean that poverty is not a factor with which teachers have to engage.
Right, and you both, the points you made here is really important to understand, is this sort of all these interconnected things that the folks working in the schools have to sort of piece out and try to address. And then the other thing is to remember, and Kevin talks about this pretty eloquently, is that students are strong. Students try to be strong, and then so it's up to the adults to figure out what's going on with them, and getting kids to talk to them and trust them. That's huge if you're going to deal with this complexity of factors. So just staying on this topic a little bit longer, this idea that poverty and family and community circumstances can hold children back from doing well in school, this is an old idea, very retro. Obviously, many of you may know or be familiar with the study that Professor James Coleman released, a report in 1966 that basically said that when it comes to improving academic achievement in the inner city, he said, what matters most is neither special programs or racial integration. These were both ideas that we were talking about back then. But rather family background and socioeconomic status. I mean, and he's concluded that we got to deal with something about poverty, not that schools can't do this, right? He didn't have a lot of faith that schools alone could help. And we see in the numbers, in broad strokes, year after year, we do see this. But I would assert that everyone in this room rejects that notion, whether you're in the excuses camp or the no excuses camp. We tend to see we tend to see and believe that schools can be the great equalizer. We have hope for this, right? And that said, I think that schools have to be very intentional in their poverty strategies and focusing on things like attendance and learning. So in this little side discussion here, I wanted to talk to our two educators, Pat Mitchell and Rudy Crew. First of all, you, Pat. We featured your work on chronic absenteeism and academics at PS 48 in Jamaica. You managed to get like some very, very dramatic results once you focus on absenteeism. And as you told me recently in an interview, you're also seeing some dramatic results in your Common Core test scores. So, you know, Pat, tell us a little, sort of inform the room, you know, in a brief, tight, colorful, exciting manner. First, right. Sort of what you did. First, though, give us your stats. That's all that matters in New York City public schools, yeah. Right? Your highest point of chronic absenteeism and your lowest point of chronic absenteeism, and also your Common Core test scores first year and second year. Okay. First of all, let's just show your bona fides.
All that, right. Okay. So I didn't know anything about the Center for New York City Affairs when I started my work as principal in 2007. So Kim contacted the school and told us we were on this list. And it looked like this, right? And I didn't want to be on that list anymore. So I set out this work to figure out what chronic absenteeism was. And what I realized was that 30% of the scholars who attended PS 48 were absent more than once a month, or some of them 20 days or more a year. And so I thought, this can't happen. I didn't want to be on Kim's list. And so I set out to combat what I found out about chronic absenteeism. So it was really simple, and I think, Deputy Mayor, you said something that principals are not trained for this work. I actually was. I was a social worker before I became an educator. So I was uniquely qualified to make home visits. I have no problem with that, right? So so the things I know that we had to do was, number one, raise awareness, and not just for parents and families, but for teachers and educators and administrators like myself who had no idea what chronic absenteeism looked like. So I thought, well, hey, we have a 90% attendance rate. That's great. 90% in anything I've ever done in my life was considered good. But in an elementary school, it is horrible.
It means
so we raised awareness about what chronic absenteeism looked like. We used data to look at this the numbers, the children who were absent chronically before, and tried to, you know, be proactive about why they were absent. We assembled a team of staff members who, in a word, they're gangster. And I'll tell you why. Because they are as passionate about attendance as I am.
And that's so hard to do at a school, is gay. Let's get passionate
is.
About attendance, guys.
It is. Well, you know. I have my ways. but I think, and then I'll get to the point, Kim. I know I'm long-winded. But for us, and panel members talked about this earlier, it's about the complexity of everything that's going on in these scholars' lives. So this team not only had to identify the problems and kind of peel the layers off the underlying reasons for children not being able to come to school, like I have to watch my younger sister, I don't have clean clothes, and then we had to figure out what to do about it. So when parents said, we don't have clean uniforms, I said, bring them in, I'll wash them. And that's what we did.
There is a washer and dryer in your school, correct?
Absolutely.
So there's something we could buy for all the schools now.
Yes. Works. It definitely works.
It's cheaper than a guidance counselor. But.
And if you've not been to a laundromat, you don't realize how expensive that could be. So we might think that's trivial, but it's not. And lastly, we had a team of people who not only celebrated attendance for children who were there every day, but we celebrated attendance rates that were improved And we communicated our goals to parents and families and all the stakeholders, and there was just a lot of buy-in. And the mayor's initiative was excellent.
Oh, yeah. I just want to really quickly for the audience.
Okay.
So in the year that we were there, which admittedly was a good year because the weather was very mild that particular year we were in the schools, I witnessed their lead person, Charlene York. She was working book after book, and she got... She reduced their chronic absenteeism list from the prior year. That's the idea. You take your kids at risk and look at them, almost down to nothing in that year, right?
Yeah,
like,
she did.
And so she went from she and Pat Mitchell's team went from something like, if I recall, 160 students that had been chronically absent the prior year to like 20 or 30 students. And so it just shows it can be done. So we can put Pat Mitchell in the no excuses camp.
Absolutely.
But the, so Dr. Rudy Crew, we've talked at length about what schools can and cannot do and what it takes to turn around, you and I. You created the Chancellor's District, which was highly structured with more money for the city's lowest performing schools at the time. Today, we probably, I don't know, do I venture to say we might have the same number of schools? I don't know. Struggling schools. And you talk about these schools and others as sort of being boats listing at sea. You know, like, where are we going? With regard to poverty and academics, like, it's okay. You can tell us what your vision is. Like, give us a few ideas about this particular subset of schools that we need to think about as a city.
Thank you. My sense is that we get lost sometimes in the conversation about public education and do not have a clear enough sort of category to understand more deeply what is the nature of the kind of schools we're now talking about. So I think, first of all, it's really helpful to have, you know, a sort of a deeper conversation about this. So in my judgment, at the time that I was here, there were roughly 1,100 schools. I would have argued 200 of them fit this category.
Mm-hmm.
I would argue that 600 fit what for me represented a category of student that was sort of in a school and in a school community that I would consider to be sort of borderline. They are very dangerously close to slipping back, if you will, even those that made progress. But maybe more importantly, they had demonstrated enough capacity in the school and in the community to actually have the school hovering right around sort of at level in reading, math, and science, and so on and so forth. And then there were roughly 300 schools that I would argue were very high-performing schools. No one ever talked about those schools being on the SIR list. No one ever, lots of parents camped out to be in those schools. People lied about their addresses to try to get into those schools. Principals, teachers all tried to figure out how, in many cases, if I'm going to be transferred, I'd like to go to one of those kind of schools.
So we not only, and we know this dynamic well at insideschools.org, where we assist all those parents who are trying to get into the schools of their choice. So those 200 schools that really were in a desperate situation, bringing it fast forward to today, first of all, do you feel like that those are the same 200 schools? Sometimes the names just change on the buildings? And then fundamentally, the idea that, like, attacking that with some both poverty and education strategies.
So what I feel about the 200 schools, roughly 200 schools, is that the system, with rare exception, does not know what to do, nor how to treat, nor how to engage, nor how to support those schools. The system generally doesn't know how to do it, largely because essentially the system is monolithic in its thinking, or at least it was. I think it's gotten, frankly, a little bit better over the years, but it's been monolithic in its thinking. So sort of everybody got the same memo, everybody got the same dollar, everybody got the same requirement, and then you were sort of off to the races to do the best you could with what you had. What I think has to happen in those schools is you really do have to double down and make a, if you will, a very well-placed strategic financial and leadership and teacher investment. And if you're not willing to do that, then the best you're going to do is tinker around the edges, frankly, write a report. I don't mean any disrespect to this.
Oh, more work for me.
No. But I'm you know.
Yeah,
I'm trying to be polite. But people will write a report. They'll bring out a few outliers at some point in time, and then we'll pat ourselves on the back in Black History Month or Hispanic Heritage Month, and we'll all then be happy. And all I will tell you is, what I would tell you is that it's the ability for the system, for the dollars, for the several billion dollar budget, and the various community-based agencies, and the enormity of the focus of City Hall. It's all of that together that then gets to double down on this very precise set of schools. Now, what and how that actually manifests itself, I have a bias about that. My own bias is that, and we did this in the Chancellor's District, I think the framework is dead wrong. You can't do this in a 180-day school year. It's just, for me, it was impossible. There's absolutely no way to do this. So if you don't double down on the length of the school day and or the length of the school year, again, I think it's just, you're fattening frogs for snakes. So the idea is that you got to put some more money into the length of day and length of year. You got to break the structure that has held these young people hostage forever. They cannot catch up. They cannot catch up in 180 school days. And so you have to be able to say things like this to people so that you can get money, right? You have to also then double down on the issue of how teachers teach in the building of a repertoire of strategies designed to actually access the brains, the genius that's inside the minds of these young people. Their problem is not their brains. Their problem is they're poor. You said it, brother. It's not about whether or not what your zip code was.
But
it's,
okay, so this is, I just want to sort of keep things moving. This is very helpful,
sorry.
And it's a perfect segue into our next, this next set of discussion. So, this is sort of Mayor de Blasio, as we all know in this room, is interested in community schools and then layering in various community and health services, so they aren't held back, so the students aren't held back by any number of things that might hold them back. For example, for obvious examples like bad vision so they can't see the blackboard, or asthma attacks, which I know really contribute to absenteeism. And this makes sense when you, it makes sense. But these schools so far have, community schools and this approach as a whole in the nation have had a very mixed record academically, perhaps also because they are really striving to work with our poorest children. So let's talk about what very low-income or low-income children need most in school to get their feet underneath them so that they have a chance of succeeding. I'm going to start with Kevin, but then I'm going to bring in Sheena and Deputy Mayor Buery. Kevin, I want Kevin to talk about this from the perspective of the little guys that he actually works with, and he sees sort of these emotional things. And then Sheena and Deputy Mayor Buery, who are both really part of the community schools push in the city, and the leaders can talk more about the big picture. But first, Kevin, you've worked with homeless children on and off since you were graduated college. And we were talking about what you see. And there's like little things as simple as homework that can create sort of a psychological a spiral for these kids. Talk about homework and then some of these other things that you have to think about when you're working with very low-income kids. Kevin.
Yeah, well, I think children, have a lot of commonalities across how they begin, and I think Mr. Buery spoke to that in his opening remarks, that you go into the pre-kindergarten class, and what do you ask, and what do you hear, and what does it sound like, and what does it look like? And if you go back to being a young student in a class and you're a part of a group, you want to be a part of that group. You want to be a part of what feels good in that group and in that classroom. A lot of times that comes down to, in the early years, handing in your homework. And if you're, you know, you go up the rows or they go down the rows and you hand up your homework, and you want to have yours there. Programs that we run when we work in the shelter with the elementary school children, it's in large part to see to it that they simply can have that homework to bring with them into school the next day. Because when they don't, they really don't want to go. They don't want to go to school and stand out as that child who just didn't have what everybody else had. And they may be feeling that on many deep levels, but if they don't have that piece of paper just to hand up with their name on it and not get called out or not get kind of the glance from the teacher or from their classmate next to them that they don't have theirs, it's significant. So we make the effort to spend the time just in those smaller granular moments with the young child to simply be with them in the places that they're going to be and that they need to be.
Right. And then the other thing that you, your organizations and others like yours do a lot of work over is this idea of grief, loss, and acute grief. Some kids lose their parents or their brothers and sisters to violence. Also, just grief that they don't have the stable life that they want. But when they're little, you hide this, and maybe when you get bigger, you hide it even better. And so, you talk about how teachers, once again, our front lines need to be trained in recognizing some of this. Talk a little, just a couple of sentences or what this looks like, and how we need to be teaching our teachers in a special way in these schools to work with these kids.
Well, trauma has been mentioned as well significantly on the panel, is a significant issue in the communities, and there are other studies that really highlight the relative scales of trauma experienced at a young age disproportionately for children in poverty. And when you come in to a school and you have experienced that trauma and your sense of the basic way that the world is going to work and function for you is shaken, isn't stable. And the expectation in the class is that people will have some kind of common experience that will allow the educator to find a common ground. But the ground that someone in that classroom is sitting on is not stable, it's shaky. And we have to understand then what kind of behaviors come out of that, because they're then often interpreted in ways that are significantly addressed with more trauma for that child and family, as opposed to understood and supported and brought into the group again. It's all about, to me, it's about bringing the child into the community,
right,
into this a sense idea of support.
Right,
not isolating them.
So right, isolating them. And we see in some schools, and we saw under Bloomberg, that a heavy emphasis on safety, of course, but it was a lot of suspensions. We have actually, we see high rates of suspensions of kindergartners, and you're going, what is going on there? What is going on with our little guys that you have to suspend them? Mm-hmm. And so the idea is that, we have to come up with strategies as a school and as community-based organizations working within schools that somehow both allow for the classroom to be calm, but also really help the children, not further isolate them. Sheena, Deputy Mayor Buery, you both put a big bet on this idea of community schools. Sheena, you're leading the effort with the first set of 45 community schools working around attendance, and obviously Mayor Buery is doing this whole huge expansion of poverty-related supports. And you both have a lot of experience in this room. Now, we often talk in these sort of broad ways, but I want both of you to sort of pick apart, like, what are the most, if you had to choose each of you, say, three things at the school level that are most promising that either community groups could do with schools or schools could do on their own for those 200 schools that we talk about. In a way to sort of hone in on, instead of just having this very large spray and pray strategy. Deputy Mayor Buery, would you like to go first and then Sheena can correct you?
That happens a lot. look, I suppose I would really have to say that I respectfully would reject the question.
Okay.
I think the problem is the idea that there are two or three things that would work for most schools is fundamentally what's in fact not true. And as I said in my remarks, every school, every family, every child present a unique set of challenges. And so the question, I think, for a school at the school level becomes, are you serious? Do you have an actual strategy and a structure, child by child, to understand what are the barriers that keep John from coming to school every day ready to learn? And do I have a strategy to support John and his family to meet those needs? It's not about saying here are the one or two things that every school needs. It's about, do you have a system for asking and answering that question and delivering on it for every child in the school? And that's why it's so complicated. And there really isn't a simple answer to that question. I mean, obviously, you know, kids need to be healthy. I mean, I keep looking at Professor Bash in the audience, who's done a lot of work to sort of connect how health plays such a central role in education. But so all these things are obviously critically important. But I really think the fundamental question is, do we have a structure as a city and as a school system to actually serve the needs of each kid? So it's possible to have a good school that can be good for most kids. But if you want to have a great school, you have to have a school that works for all children. And that's what's so devilishly difficult, and I think really tests our commitment to the notions of equal opportunity and universal education that we all espouse. I mean, as a city, you know, I think we're committed to it for 90% of the kids, 95% maybe, but I'm not sure that we've ever really demonstrated that we're committed to it for 100% of our kids. Mm-hmm. And that's, I think, what we're trying to get to.
Okay, and Sheena, when you and I were talking about the actual dynamics at the school, particularly working with community partners, which is, you know, is hard to do effectively. We all know of it. I know that overseeing that. I think your quote was, it's hard as hell.
So yeah, my staff told me not to, don't say that.
Don't swear in front of Kim. Yes. But, you know, so talk about the actual gut work that has to happen in the principal's office and with the community partners so that we can so we really can see change. And you know this firsthand.
Right. And I think just kind of bringing together, I think, what a bunch of what has been said before, I think the answer to what do low-income children need most is what they need most. So, and a school system, you know, as big, you know, the biggest school system in the country cannot, you know, diagnose the needs for every particular child, but can provide a framework and resources and tools for that to happen. And I think that is what the community schools model does. I mean, it allows for a time for diagnosis. Okay. When you said, you know, the principals were shocked when they saw there's so much data that can be assembled and put together so that, you know, school leaders, community-based organizations can actually develop a real actionable plan for their kids and their school and their communities. And that's a foundation of the community schools and making sure that you have that action plan.
Talk about the hecticness in a real school.
How
hectic it is.
Oh,
and finding that time and like what is required so that you can help the principals when they have two. I've witnessed this. Three children outside their door. One's bawling. Another has an angry mother. Like, so what to give the principals the time to do this and to give
right.
the community what needs.
So I think, you know, another core element of community schools is it leverages the assets of community. We've talked a lot about poverty and these communities are so challenged and so terrible. There are a lot of assets in low-income neighborhoods and communities and a lot of strength. And what community schools model does is says, let's draw on those assets in a very strategic way to fit the actual needs in this school, and let's knit it together in mutually reinforcing ways to produce the results that we want to have. And in order to do that, you need leadership at schools, like certainly we have represented here, that are passionate, that are committed, that are resourceful, that have a different, I think, suite of skills than you might learn in a typical teacher's college. But even though we have to be very specific, we have to create this framework where you can develop those really solution plans and also have the resources to execute. And so I think those things are critically important. So the diagnosis and the really knitting together in a strategic way, there is no time and space to do that in the school structure now. There are no resources for planning. There are no resources for collaboration. How do we pull in community-based organizations and other institutions and service providers? Those resources just don't exist. But what the community schools model does is it provides a framework that brings all these pieces together at the neighborhood level, at the school level, and at the system level. I mean, what's happening, I think, with the children's cabinet, and really trying to map, you know, to take a child and appreciate that they're connected to ACS, that they're connected to DHS, that they're connected to all of these other systems, and to bring all of that data so you can have an actionable plan that's actually going to make sense for that child could be completely transformational for these schools.
But so you mentioned a word, resources, and we call it money.
Yes.
So let's talk about that. The first, with the administration, obviously Bill de Blasio made some great campaign promises about tremendous investment in this city. But when it comes to the community schools, so far, the announcements have been basically repurposing existing dollars more towards this, say, smarter goal. But when we talk about the level of need, particularly in the highest need schools, do we need more people, more staff, yes, more something, or do we need different thinking? Dr. Crew, I'd like you to start, and then Pat a little bit, and Kevin, from your perspectives, just quick, like this idea of money, or because I definitely always heard in the Klein administration, they're like, money doesn't solve things. it's more that you have to think differently, think smarter. So Dr. Crew?
So I think you have to carve out the space for this to be a conversation about the redistribution of resources. What you have is you have the need to treat schools differently based upon the enormity, the intensity, and the database that you showed here this morning. That does not augur well in communities that think you're essentially taking a dollar from them to be able to spend it on kids who are less worthy or less smart. So let's just be real about this for a second. The second thing is that if you're going to redistribute resources, then you actually have to train people to know how to use the resources they're given. This is not a question about just giving people money and then saying, have at it, do the best you can do, we'll see you next week. This is about being very targeted, very specific, very strategic about what points of leverage, to use Sheena's term, what points of leverage actually will add value to a child's ability to do their homework, to pass it in, to have clothes, to be able to have clean uniforms, whatever it may be in their respective community. And third, I think that you actually have to provide a way of being able to recognize that more money will be needed for kids who are poor. It's just that simple. And nothing in America has ever been more, you know, sort of contested than this notion of poor people, poor children, poor families needing something additional. And we keep going up against this very, very hard ethic that somehow or another it's their fault that they're poor and thus they don't need anything from me or anybody else. What they really need is they need a culture that says, listen, your predicament may be what it is today, but it will not be that tomorrow. And so, this whole redistribution issue is a redistribution issue that can only be led, in this instance, by people who are in a policy position to basically keep the wolves at bay around this issue of redistributing money to people who essentially need it.
Thank you, Dr. I want to talk to stay on this question for another minute, but meanwhile, I want everybody who has questions on their index cards, we're going to send staff down the aisles, and we're going to start collecting them, and then my colleague, Nicole Mader, is going to sort of sift through and try to find questions that haven't already been asked and all this, and I will start just firing the questions at the panel willy-nilly. Kevin and Pat, do you think that more money is really important in the work that you do, or is it, and if so, what, like, is it just more money, or is it very tactically spent money, or do you think that it's a matter of just knowing how to operate, knowing how to operate better? Either way, Kevin first.
Sure. Yeah, I mean, I think it's all of that, and right. I think what Dr. Crew said really spoke to me a lot, and it brings up to me one of the fundamental questions is what impact will education have on poverty? So if we can demonstrate that the improved education will diminish the poverty in a particular community with that same people who are living in that community, then I think we've done something that will allow people to continue the conversation and say we need more resources because look what we're accomplishing. I think part of the challenge is you do need more resources, you redistribute the resources, and if the community looks the same unless it gentrifies, then nothing really has happened that makes education and poverty have an important link whatsoever.
So Pat, do you, Pat, you did a lot with very little extra money. So what would you say you do need money for if you do, and a lot can be done without it?
Okay, so I completely understand what Dr. Crew is saying. It's not just about pouring money into schools, but being strategic about how to use it. Furthermore, the structures that you alluded to are so important. I spent a day at Harlem Success last Thursday just to see what goes on and how they got a 97% proficiency rate for math for their scholars. I get it. Their framework is very, very different than what we work under in the New York City DOE. So it's not just about the amount of money they get, but what they do with that money. So I am about looking at models of success. So I don't care where I have to go to see it, I want to see it.
But so you're saying that you saw pedagogy and classroom approaches that you want to try to emulate yourself?
Absolutely. So the instructional core is there, but the instructional core is based on the structure that's set up for success. So before you even get to the classroom, how are we going to support administrators, teachers, and families drive excellence?
So Deputy Mayor Buery, you on this panel, you represent not only the mayor, but you're representing the Department of Education as well. We obviously have your plan for the renewal schools that came out to great fanfare on Monday, but we're also waiting to understand what school support is gonna look like in this city. It's always been something that's been tough for chancellors. I believe Claire and I witnessed this. Chancellor Klein changed his school support system 4 times under his single tenure. And school support, for those of you who may not know, the two of you in this room, that it's this idea that you have this principles and that there's a whole team of people who can help you train your teachers better, deal with attendance, deal with poverty issues, order your school lunches, make sure the electricity is on. That's school support. And we're waiting January, there's gonna be a big announcement about how school support and accountability is gonna change in the city again. But fundamental to what the administration is saying is this, it's all gonna be driven with this idea that it's trust-based and community-driven, and community schools are a very important sort of idea there. There is real concern out there that these ideas, so far at least, are too diffuse or unproven, or that maybe we're retreading on old ground. So, Deputy Mayor Buery, I want you, this has been discussed in the papers this week, talk about that, sort of take that on and say why we're not going back in time.
Well, first of all, anyone here who knows Carmen Farina know that she does not really need me to stand here and articulate for her vision for the school system. But let me just say a few things. I think at Chancellor Farina's heart is the idea that what it takes to build great schools are collaborative environments of well-trained and supported professionals. And so what she's been working on, what the system's been working on, is figuring out what is the best way to support and inspire hardworking and engaged professionals in schools so they can make good decisions for their schools on the ground. I want to just, if I could, sort of step back to the other question a little bit,
sure,
because I think it's relevant. And, you know, I'm going to preface this because I really do have the greatest respect, great respect for Joel Klein. I have respect for anyone who takes on the job of leading the school system, which is not a job for the meek. But it's also been my experience that only rich people ever say that money doesn't matter. And I say that to say that not that, of course, it matters how you spend those resources, and much of the work that we're talking about are not about new resources, but of course money and resources matter. And part of what we're trying to do with the system is figure out how to best deploy those resources so that the children who need it have it. And a lot of the investments we're making, whether it's around pre-kindergarten or after-school programs for middle school students or community schools, is really thinking about how do we effectively and efficiently deploy resources so that they can do the most good for children. I'll just finally end where I started in my remarks is that changing a school system is not easy. A school system of a million plus kids is not easy. And anybody who says they have the one way to fix something, I've learned to ignore them because there isn't just one way to fix something. This is if it was easy, it would have been figured out by now. Somebody would have done it by now. And I think too much we are wrapped up in these false debates between the idea, you know, just to characterize it, you know, it's no excuses. All that matters is what is, you know, poverty doesn't matter, or the other extreme that you can't solve anything in schools until you solve poverty. I mean, this is all sort of a false dialogue. Of course, you need to have better instruction. You need to hold schools accountable. And of course, you need to address the real world situations that make it difficult for teachers to teach and make it difficult for students to participate in the classroom. And so I don't think what you're gonna get from the school system is not gonna be sort of this, here's our two bullets for how to fix school. I mean, it doesn't work that way. I mean, it makes for poor press releases and it makes it easier to attack the school system because you didn't tell us what your magic plan was for improving schools. But the magic plan for improving schools is finding good principals and teachers and supporting them and connecting them to resources and slogging through that difficult work every day. And there's no other magic than that. It's just the hard work of going into buildings and working with kids.
Okay, and I want to end with this and go into our questions, but with a comment that Dr. Crew made to me that I want to sort of address to Sheena. It was interesting when we interviewed Dr. Crew initially about the idea of school improvement for our community schools report, which came out a couple weeks ago. He talked about a lot of things, but he really didn't talk about the role of community-based organizations and nonprofits at all as being part of the solution. And then I came back to him recently. I said, do you think that they have a role? And he said, yes, they're becoming more sophisticated and they have a role. And there's crucial to what the de Blasio administration wants to do. But he goes, it's hard to assemble an army of people who fundamentally don't want to be led. And I get that. Like the nonprofit sector, which I've been covering as a journalist for over 25 years, is very individualistic, and on the other side, schools are very they have their ways, right? And so very, very hard to move in their own way. So I guess a challenge, and Sheena, you've dealt with this, is like, are you part of, you're one of those generals in this army. What do you say about this need for the nonprofit sector to become more sophisticated to deal with the needs of schools? And Dr. Crew, you can chime in afterwards, if this is your quote.
Yeah. Oh, wow. No. I guess I would not even kind of use the analogy of a general. I don't think community-based organizations that are really focused on community improvement see themselves as the general as much as they are servants in service to the community. And the relationship between a community-based organization and the school has to be a partnership. Too much of what I think has happened has been very siloed, very distinct, and not at all integrated or aligned. But I think there are many community-based organizations that have worked extremely effectively in partnership with schools. They're members of the school leadership team. They're really a part of the school community. And the community is a part of, and the schools are certainly fundamentally a part of that community-based organization in a significant way. So there are models that exist and that can work. And when I thought about when you'd mentioned this kind of general and the war kind of analogy, one of the things, you know, we were trying to really figure out how do we help people understand what the United Way is and what it does, and someone actually came up with a sports analogy as opposed to a war analogy. I'm not that sophisticated when it comes to sports. I ran track, right? There, it's very simple. But they use this analogy, and I thought it was a good one. in terms of kind of all the pieces that are needed in order to kind of win, essentially. And, you know, you have an owner who really says, you know, this is going to be the strategy that we're going to set because we want to win the championship. Then you have a general manager whose job it is to pick the players on the team, and they pick the players based on each player's unique skills and assets and attributes and personalities. Then you have the coach that is actually on the sidelines, you know, coaching and figuring out what's happening during the game, adjusting. And then you have the players, the people that are doing the direct work on the ground. And the way we look at it is that the owners are the community. The community includes the schools and community-based organizations. It includes parents and families. And they have to own the strategy. And that's core to our work. And then all of the other pieces are lining up to serve that purpose. So you can have a general manager like the United Way that helps really curate a body of community-based organizations that serve a specific purpose, knit them together so that they can support the community and its plan for improvement for its schools. Then you have coaches like resource coordinators that are on the ground directing the day-to-day work. And then you have the direct service organizations that are actually serving the need. So you know, the general approach, I don't think is the right analogy. We have to work together as a team, and that has to be a hallmark of the work that community-based organizations do with schools.
Okay, that was helpful. And I'm going to start on the questions now. First of all, we have a class here from Brooklyn Collaborative Studies. You got to love a guys. So they, you got to love it that when you bring your students out to policy, things like this. And their teacher submitted a question that's good for across the board. The use of data. Okay, so then that was sort of core to what I was talking about in this, in the PowerPoint. Data. That was what was really what drove the Bloomberg administration in so many ways. But I would say that it actually is very useful to school personnel and CBOs in to try to figure out what they're doing right and wrong, right? However, it is extremely time consuming to analyze on your own. I can tell you that. That's where I have Nicole do it all for me. So how can the city or the DOE make it easier for teachers and principals to sort of look at this data, maybe for more of the poverty level and also education data, but so that they really can make it more useful in their classroom So, Dr. Crew, I want to start with you, and then we'll anybody else who wants to chime in.
Could you just sharpen the question for me?
Sure. How can we sort of change the nature of data from these giant spreadsheets that are overwhelming for schools into something that they could use instantaneously tomorrow, and make use of for their kids?
Yeah, I think I want to frame my answer both to that and to the comment that Sheena made a minute ago. So I think that this notion of working in silos obviously is self-defeating, but what I said in my quote and how I'll answer the other question is that we have been playing footsies with organizations around this notion of collaboration for a very long period of time. We did not act as though there was, at least for some children, we did not act with an urgency about really being able to do more than just accommodate each other's sort of interests. That level of work, however sexy it might have been, was inappropriate for the task of being able to really nudge the needle of poor kids in poor schools living day to day in poverty. And my comment was, in order to be able to do that, you have to have an army of people who have an urgency in now to be able to actually put together and put aside all the petty politics that comes with interagency and school-based collaboration. And people have to set their egos aside and blend resources in a way and blend data in a way that allows for people to activate a kind of a collaborative around the data. So I don't think it's about any one institution having the data. It's about how interactive are the data points such that interagency collaboration results from those kinds of discussions.
And this is a big issue. Yeah, it's a very big issue. I'm glad we actually keyed in on it because I do a couple page article, and I've talked to Deputy Mayor Buery about this. Data sharing between schools and the nonprofit sector the nonprofit partners that they're working with, which is very sensitive. It's very important and it's very sensitive. I want to sort of bring that up, sort of what that looks like. Now, just to give you a sense of, in an ideal world, you would have, say, a resource coordinator in the school, and those are folks perhaps hired by the nonprofit that you know, are higher level social worker types, who could see which kids they needed to be most concerned about, and how you could sort of layer in some help and support using these community partnerships. Like that's the idea here, right? Very, very sort of important idea. But the way it works in both schools and city agencies and nonprofits is that all of these different data sets are protected by federal privacy or by privacy laws, and also protected by people who have common sense that they don't want to necessarily be sharing very sensitive information. So how do we break through that, Deputy Mayor Buery?
Well, we're working to change that every day. I mean, I think the central question, I think, is that in order for this strategy to be effective, everyone has to take responsibility for all of the factors that lead to long-term success. So it can't be that only the doctors care about the health outcomes, only the teacher cares about the academic outcomes, only the, you know, go across the list. Everybody has to care about all the outcomes that matter to children, and we need to have a platform that allows everyone responsibly to have access to the information that allow them to make better decisions for children.
Sort of a common platform, like an actual computer that you guys could all log into?
That would give everybody in the school who has a need to have the information access to data to help them make better decisions about students, but also that create a common way of talking about what success actually looks like for the student and school community. So we're working to achieve that in a number of ways, and it's a part of the community school model. Just one example, one of the initiatives that Mayor Bloomberg began under Deputy Mayor Linda Gibbs is something called HHS Connect, which is a tool that basically allows caseworkers from different parts of city government to access data about clients from another area of city government. So for example, a ACS caseworker being able to look up data about homeless data about a child, about the same child. And so part of what we've been doing at the city under the Children's Cabinet is expanding the data that is part of that tool and expanding who can access to it. And we're beginning a pilot this year that would have a small number of schools also being able to access that data.
Because right now they don't get, it's not easy for them to see this stuff, right?
No. So we're building those tools as we speak, and we're also working with partners, looking at data platforms, looking at dashboards, for lack of a better word, that would help give community-based providers and schools access to data in the same way in real time. So it's not easy work. There are technical challenges, there are legal challenges, but those are only challenges. None of these things are obstacles that are impossible to overcome. It just requires careful engagement, and it starts with understanding the priority of this work. So we're gonna continue to make good progress in overcoming some of those obstacles.
And I, obviously, when you talk about things that might be game changers going forward, they have giving everybody much more efficient information on the students so that they could provide the right kind of help is an idea, is an important idea.
Jump in on that for
sure,
a second.
Sure.
I mean, I think data certainly will bring efficiency. I think data is for assessment. Mm-hmm. And I think that you don't need to wait. I mean, the data will help the assessment, but you don't need to wait for the data to do mm-hmm. the assessment. And when you're talking about access to data, I'm thinking about access to voices within making that assessment. Who's making that assessment? What's the conversation in the assessment? And in particular, talking about community-based organizations being involved in that, well, the first community-based organization would be the parent organization in that school. And what mm-hmm. voice do they have in the assessment? So I think sometimes the lack of data, certainly from a nonprofit point of view, we want that. We want to see those reforms happen and move forward. But sometimes it really can then become an excuse to say, well, we can't do a thorough assessment, when really what's happening is people are being blocked out from including their voice to really share what would improve the school or would be needed in the community.
No, that's right.
Oh, yeah, I'm sorry. Okay. My next question is on this idea of parents, but you can...
I'm just agreeing, and I think... there are a number of strategies around the country that have done that are not complicated, that are not technology intensive. They're looking at ways really to get all the people in the school and the community who understand the child's needs and to collect all that data so that teachers and school leaders can act on it. It's a great work in Boston by a group called City Connect. So there's lots of things that we can learn from here in New York City, and it's not all about complicated technology strategies. But at the same time, there's a lot of information and data we have about a lot of these kids who are often engaged by a number of city agencies. And part of what we're trying to do with the city generally, and it certainly reflects this work, is to try as much as possible to get away from a system that is focused on the needs of individual bureaucracies, but try to get back to having a system that's focused around the needs of children. And just how do we connect this information so that this teacher, on a very basic level, have a fuller picture of the challenges this child faces, so that you begin to say, who are the partners that would be best able to support this child? So again, you're absolutely right. We don't have to wait for perfection to do good work, but at the same time, we can try to move towards perfection.
And then Kevin mentioned parents, which is something we haven't talked about enough here. And we have a question here. While we've heard a lot about community assets, and I do apologize if we're, I try to keep our jargon down to a minimum, but it's still hard in this setting. We've heard a lot about community assets. I'm not hearing nearly enough about this actual parent input into these schools and these ideas. Sort of discuss that. Who wants to take, I'll start with Patricia Pat on this one. She drove everything and has a close communicative relationship with parents. But Pat, were you telling me that at the end of the day, in terms of the academic outcomes, in terms of getting the kids to learn, you can't necessarily rely on the parents. It really needs to be something that happens in the classroom. What is your relationship with parents with your success, and what's sort of fraught about that as well? Sort of the tensions here.
All right. So being a parent, I get it, and so I don't do anything without my parents. I respect the partnership, and I realize that we can't move scholars without their help or consent. But I just want to talk, if I may, Kim, about that we're talking about these community-based organizations. They are vital to the success of any school culture. And so one of the things we realized that we had to be clear about was we wanted to create a culture and a space for scholars that they wanted to come to, no matter what. So we talked about, is this a place scholars want to come to? So the community-based organizations, I was sitting down listening to Deputy Mayor, and I said, Mike, you know what? I never thought about me being a community school. I've never called myself that yet, but I will, if I can get some money.
I think everybody should.
Absolutely.
Then de Blasio will have achieved his goal of 100% community schools, if we all
absolutely. So we have 15-plus community partnerships at PS 48, and they all work directly with parents. So I don't know if I've violated any federal laws, but I do share data because I think it's important. But not without parents' consent. And not just quantitative data, qualitative data. Yeah. There is no data that's going to report to me that a mom's been battered, but I get it. So we need some social emotional help. But the 15 organizations that I work with are well orchestrated. We have to work with data. So I can't have organizations and CBOs, whom I love, we can't do this work without them, bumping into each other. Mm-hmm. So Jumpstart is working with pre-K, and Read Alliance is working with kindergarten and first grade, and Reading Partners works with grades 2 through 5. The YMC will work with my fifth graders. So it's very strategic and vital. And so when you talked about, Sheena, this work not being done absolutely not done during the school day. So we make these things happen when the scholars are gone and the teachers are missed some upstairs.
And so you're saying, but the key there is that a big part of what you do for the kids and the parents is through your partnerships with
absolutely.
The CEOs. And,
yeah.
And I like that term you said, we got to keep them, we have to use data so we make sure they're not bumping into each other. Because
exactly.
I think we see a lot of that in schools that if it's not well organized. The others want to talk about the idea of parent?
Yeah.
Sheena?
You know, when I use the term community, parents and families comprise community. That the people that live there, that are sending their kids, they're the major stakeholders, the biggest, you know, customer, as you will, and partner and contributor to the success. So parents are critically important. And in the work, certainly that we're doing at United Way and that I did at the Absentee Development Corporation, we partnered certainly with parents as individuals, but also with advocacy groups, a Coalition for Educational Justice, which is a major partner of ours, in really amplifying parent voice around some of the issues, challenges, and solutions and assets that parents bring to the table. When you talk about respect, I think one of the things that was really very challenged in the previous administration was the profound lack of respect for parents. I think that's a fact. And I think how the systems and structures were set up really underscored that level of disrespect. And I think one of the things that I'm starting to see with this new administration, and I think is very promising and very important, is that we have to adjust the structure of our engagement with parents and make it more convenient for them. I think in one of the speeches I just heard recently, I think it was de Blasio's speech on Monday, he said, if you really want parents to come to parent-teacher conferences, you can't have it at 2:00 on a Tuesday. Mm-hmm. And then you say, oh, the parents don't come. Where are they? I mean, they're supposed to really like take a day off of work when, you know, work is not making ends meet to come at 2:00. And he told an example of you know, having the meeting in an evening. I know there's one set of schools, Eagle Academy, they do them on Saturdays. And you see 90% of the parents show up. They want to be there and engage with their teachers for their kids. They care, they're committed, they want to contribute and partner. But if you don't respect them enough to appreciate, you know, and make it, you know, inviting and really say this is a real partnership, then you're not going to see it. So that it's critically important. And I don't know if you look at Dr. Crew's description of those sets of schools, and I thought it was just really helpful to kind of group them. Those 300 schools at the top, heavy parent respect, heavy parent engagement. That's a key factor in success.
Oh, that's very helpful. Thank you. So they, we have like one more minute here, and I wanted to just go down the line again, and we'll go from Kevin to Deputy Mayor Buery, since he's gonna. So, what one piece of advice would you give to Mayor de Blasio about his idea around community schools, and Deputy Mayor Buery will write it down. No. What one piece of advice would you give to Mayor de Blasio about concerning the lowest income kids in the city? Kevin, start with you.
Just one?
Just one. And then you can write to me afterwards. I'll forward it. Anybody?
Really is a tough question to sort of center on what the one thing would be. I guess it would be back to something that's been said many times, which is not to make the community school model a monolithic model, use Dr. Crew's word, just that the sort of the main point being that each community is going to be different and there needs to be a responsiveness to the needs, even when we talk about poverty. And I think the risk factors and the load factors identified in this report begin to give some texture to that word. I think it still is going to mean something very different in each place that you go. So I think that the level of assessment that needs to be done at each school and matching the resources to that assessment is what I would say would be the key factor in success for that.
Great. Pat?
Okay. So if I had one wish, I would ask for more support to that we could provide for our scholars and their families or around social emotional development. So, and support. And so if we find out, if we can, you know, peel back the layers and find out what the issues are, but I don't have a full-time guidance counselor at all, or I don't have a SAPIS worker in my school, and we need them in elementary school, then I can't really support families. I can only be sympathetic. And so I want to be strategic. So if I could ask for one thing, it would be to have more support early, elementary school, to support families' social, emotional development.
Okay, great.
I second that.
Dr. Crew?
I would ask that the administration focus on developing a policy context in which the architecture of schooling and the delivery of schooling is completely differentiated now. And by that, I mean that it would mean that we would have agreements in certain sections of the city, specialized agreements, and where you're talking about the community schools, there are probably 5, maybe 7, 10 very specific high poverty communities where the relationship between the elementary, middle, and high school, and even the community college or the four-year institution in that area should be bookend by an agreement that essentially says, in 4 years, during my term, we're going to move the needle for parents, for children, and for schools in the following ways. And then they come up with a plan to be able to do that. The second thing that I would ask, the second part of that would be that they have the opportunity to then budget for those 5 to 7 places throughout the city. The budget requirements are going to be very different in Jamaica, Queens, and on Jamaica Avenue specifically, or Central Brooklyn where I am, or Harlem and so forth. Those budget requirements are going to be very distinct and very different. Third portion of that would be that these agreements would be bordered by community agencies, churches, parent organizations that allow for the rules of engagement to be rethought, to be organically and truly changed to be able to reflect the needs of the community. And the last portion of that agreement would be that they use the arts as a way to be able to develop cognitive modalities for how children learn to read, write, and be men.
That sounds easy. Well, we got our plan right there. Sheena, thank you, Dr. Kerr.
Thank you. That's a lot of good stuff. The one I'll pick, I think, is really about this report. And I don't think this is just a report. I think this is a tool that can be used to really drive policy. And I appreciate this administration's focus on universality, universal pre-K, universal after school for middle school. The community school's initial kind of RFP was open to 700 schools that were below a certain list. But I think that this poverty load factor should give schools extra points and access to resources. Because quite frankly, communities, and we're focused on, you know, the 10 neighborhoods in the city of New York that have the highest concentration of deep poverty and have been like that, right, for decades and decades and decades and decades. And that's where we're really focusing our efforts. And there's a lot of resource allocation at the federal level and others, kind of your needs analysis will give you extra points. And I think what we might be starting to see is that these universal opportunities for additional resources are not getting to those communities because of the capacity that you need to write the proposal and to pull all that stuff together in a very compressed time frame. The resources are just not there for it. So a special focus, I think, as Dr. Crew said, on those neighborhoods. Use this as a tool for allocating those resources. And it's, you know, there was a conversation about kind of reallocating resources. It's an investment that has significant returns, and I think this administration appreciates that, and I think that this is a critical tool that can be used to really drive change in these neighborhoods and communities.
Well, thank you for the plug. And finally, Deputy Mayor Buery, what advice would you give the mayor? And you have the last word here today.
I'm just going to take everything you all said. I'll package it up and take credit for it. So. This is generally how I do things. Let me just actually, just to wrap up, just to really thank you. I just want to thank you and thank the center for the incredible work of pulling this information together. It's amazing how information that you sort of know, in your heart, how helpful it is to see it organized, validated, and systematized in a way that you can actually use to inform policy. So I think it's an important role the center has played, and I really do appreciate this work. And what it's worth, know that we will really take this information back and understand how it informs our practice. And the other thing, the last thing I will say, just for everyone in the audience, I know folks are here from different parts of the world. This, I'll say, as I said a couple times already, this work is extraordinarily complicated. And the only thing that I know is that to move the system forward is going to take all of us. And everybody here in New York, whatever you do, wherever you do for a living, wherever you live, there's a school nearby. Find out what's going on in that school. Find out what they need. Find out how you can be supportive. With all the work we can do systematically, there's amazing work that we can do with individual citizens. And so just encourage you all to stay engaged and stay active. And thank you.
All right. Thank you. Thanks to the panel. And extra reports are available if anybody wants to take some back to their colleagues and staff members. There are some extra reports available outside. And feel free to contact me with any questions. My email is on the inside cover.